Welcome to AP Calculus BC. We've got section 11.2 today, vectors in the plane, the penultimate lesson of our entire Calc BC course. All right, we're going to start just like yesterday, looking back at pre-calculus. We covered vectors in chapter 6 of that class. A two-dimensional vector, remember, it is a directed line segment. It has magnitude and direction. And remember, we represent a vector with a bold and italicized letter. It's an ordered pair given inside some chevron symbols is the technical term there. And that's referred to as component form. And when we look at that A, B ordered pair in the chevrons there, that's saying it moves A amount in the X direction horizontally and B amount vertically. So those are component forms. A is the horizontal component, B the vertical component. The standard representation of the vector is an arrow from the origin to that point after moving so much horizontally and so much vertically. All right, a vector has a magnitude. Here's where a tiny little thumbnail sketch could be helpful here. So let's say we have a vector going from the origin directed to the point AB. That vector has a magnitude or length given by v. Sometimes you will see this as a double absolute value bar. That's the notation that we used last year. Our textbook just uses absolute values, and we're supposed to understand that absolute value of a vector means its magnitude. Either one's acceptable. But you'll notice that to find the magnitude, if we've gone some distance A in the horizontal direction and some distance B in the vertical direction, we could use Pythagorean theorem to find the length of that directed line segment. And that's exactly what we do. So we find the magnitude by using the Pythagorean theorem to find that hypotenuse. All right, the direction angle, we can find that using right triangle trig as well. How far did I rotate off the positive x-axis to get that line segment directed at point AB? The head minus tail rule, if we have a vector going from one point to another, it doesn't start at the origin, we can express it in standard form as if it were starting at the origin, simply by taking the difference in the x values, the change in x, the difference in the y values, the change in y. Notice that it's always end minus beginning. That's the head minus tail. The head of our vector is where the arrow is at, and the tail is where it originated from. So head minus tail with the x's, head minus tail with the y's. The order does matter there. If we have two vectors that we are adding up, then the resultant vector of that addition is simply adding up the horizontal components, adding up the vertical components. Very simple. Okay, we can scalar multiply vectors as well, and the zero vector represents a vector 0, 0 with no length or definitive direction. All right, operations with vectors. Here you can see, and these are self-explanatory. We covered a majority of these last year. These make sense. There's commutativity, there's associativity, since we're simply adding components. Obviously, there's an identity, an additive identity of 0. If we take the zero vector time zero as a scalar times any vector, that will produce the zero vector. And also scalar multiplying is associative. We can still distribute, either adding up a scalar and distributing it, or distributing a single scalar to a sum of two vectors. So all of these operations, again, this is just kind of like, if I gave it to you without any instruction, you could probably guess what it is. It's just like you'd expect. All right, now for the calculus aspect of vectors. We're going back, way back, to when we looked at derivatives in chapter 4, I believe, maybe chapter 5, where we were talking about how derivating takes us from position to velocity to acceleration, and we can do that here with calculus as well. Vectors very useful in physics for describing motion and forces. So here a position vector is given as, oh look, a vector, and it looks like a parametric function from last section. Well, then we've got a velocity vector, which is simply the first derivative of each of those functions. And then the speed, remember that's a number. So that's the magnitude of our velocity. Speed is velocity without a direction. So it's a number, not a vector. Okay, then we go into the acceleration vector. That is the second derivative of each of our functions, and the direction of motion is the direction vector. We called it last year the unit vector. We take our vector v in component form and just divide out the magnitude. That'll give us a vector of length 1 pointing in the direction that we need. All right, so that's how derivatives help us out with vector calculus. Now let's look at displacement. How are the integrals going to come into play? Well, just like again in chapter 6 when we looked at definite integrals and that meaning a net change, we talked about that again in chapter 8, I believe. We can do that here with the parametric functions within a vector. So now, to find the displacement, we take our velocity vector and we integrate it from some parameter t, usually time. We integrate that x, that horizontal component, we integrate that y component, that will give us the distance traveled in each of those respective directions. And then this all ties together beautifully with our arc length formula. If we want to find the distance traveled, well then we're integrating the absolute value of our velocity vector. So we're finding the arc length of our velocity. This is just all those little hypotenuse measurements added up, the sum of those triangle hypotenuses, just like we talked about last section. So a lot of it ties together very, very nicely. All right, we're going to start off with some very, very easy, get the ground under our feet examples with how vectors are represented. So we've got a point A at the point 2, 3, and that's where it's starting. And that vector is ending up at the origin. So we're going to apply our head minus tail rule. So our vector v is going to equal, in our chevrons, that's component form, we've got an x-coordinate of 2. Oops, sorry, I'm doing it backwards. Head minus tail, we end up at a 0 x-coordinate. We started off with a 2. Head minus tail, 0 minus 2, 0 minus 3. So that vector, negative 2, negative 3. It's the same vector, the same amount of distance traveled in the exact same direction as if I had started at the origin and gone negative 2 in the horizontal, negative 3 in the vertical. I get the exact same vector again. All right. Here, vector is symbolized not as a ray, as that kind of appears in your notes, but more of a harpoon. There's only one little slant on the arrow there. So here we've got the vector going from point O to point P. So again, we're going to do head minus tail. Visually, we can think about this going from 1, 2, 5 to negative 1, 7. So there we are, and there we are, our vector traveling like so. And we're not instructed to make a graph, it's just to make some comprehensive notes here. So our vector, head minus tail, negative 1 minus 2, 7 minus 5. That gives us a horizontal component of negative 3 units traveled, and sure enough, 1, 2, 3 horizontal units. And vertically, we go up 2 when we do 7 minus 5. That's exactly what we're seeing in our vector. Find the magnitude and the direction angle. So you've seen these little right triangles show up. We have an awful lot at our disposal with right triangles. We've got Pythagorean theorem. We've got SOHCAHTOA, some right triangle trig going on. So we can find an awful lot about a right triangle, and that's what these vectors are creating. So magnitude of the vector negative root 2, root 2. Okay, well that tells me if I were to start this at the origin, I would go negative root 2 units horizontally, and then I would go positive root 2 units vertically to get to the head of that vector, the end point. All right, well, magnitude of that vector here is going to be the square root of negative root 2 squared plus positive root 2 squared. I should call that the magnitude of the vector. Magnitude of vector v, and I'm sorry, I'm using the double absolute value, that special bracketing, just out of habit from teaching pre-calculus. So the magnitude of v is equal to the square root of 2 plus 2, square root of 4, magnitude is 2. And again, any freshman geometry student could tell you that that 45, 45, 90 is going to have a hypotenuse that is root 2 times the length of one of its legs. The direction angle that it forms starts in the positive x-axis, and we want to find that theta. All right, well, to do that, and let's assume that we didn't know this was a 45, 45, 90, what we could do is look at the reference angle inside. All right, well, the reference angle inside has a tangent of root 2 over negative root 2. So the tangent of our reference angle, oops, I'm getting ahead of myself, tangent of our reference angle, theta prime, is equal to root 2 over negative root 2. Then if we want the angle as an output, we would use tangent inverse, and that ratio is negative 1. So theta prime is 45 degrees. I'm working in degrees because that's the interval they specified. And then we can use supplementary angles. Yeah, we get to throw some geometry into this. Theta is therefore 180 minus 45, 135 degrees for our direction angle. A vector is a quantity represented by an arrow that has both magnitude and direction. Magnitude of 2, direction of 135 degrees. Let's look at letter B. All right, to construct this vector, we're starting at the origin, or imagining starting at the origin. Negative 2 units horizontally, and then negative 2 root 3, that's about 3.4 vertically. So we're ending up somewhere about there. All right, turn that into a nice little right triangle for us. And again, if we're well versed in our geometry, we can recognize that this is a 30, 60, 90 right triangle scaled up by a factor of 2. So this hypotenuse should be 4. And we can always fall back on our Pythagorean theorem, because it might not always be this clean. But we've got negative 2 squared plus 2 root 3 squared, which is 12. And when we square root that sum, we find the magnitude of that vector to be 4. So confirmed. All right, direction angle. Again, let's assume that we don't know that this is a 30, 60, 90 right triangle. In order to find the full angle that we rotate through theta, let's look at the reference angle, theta prime. And that reference angle, theta prime, has a tangent that is negative 2 root 3 over negative 2. Well, then theta prime would be the angle whose tangent, or inverse tangent, of root 3. Theta prime then equals 60 degrees. And again, we should already know all of this. I'm just working through how we would solve it if it wasn't a nice special right triangle. Well, in this case, our theta is going to be 180 degrees, right? Full 180 degrees plus our reference angle. We can tell that from the geometry of our vector. So we've got 180 plus 60, 240 degrees. Magnitude and direction. Example 3, find the component form of the vector with the given magnitude that forms the given direction angle. All right. Again, let's imagine that we have not had much experience with vectors before. I know that I rotate through pi over 6 radians from the positive x-axis, and then I sketch in my vector that has a magnitude of 2 root 3. And I need to find the component form. So I need to find this x component and this y component, the vertical and horizontal components there. And we may remember from last year, if not, SOHCAHTOA would lead us to this point. X is going to be the magnitude of that vector times the cosine of our direction angle. and y will be the magnitude times the sine of our direction angle. It's kind of like, if we remember our turn and throw polar coordinates from last year, and we'll talk more about those next section, but very much that type of plotting when we're thinking about a vector drawn from a direction angle. All right, so our component form, let's see. Our magnitude is 2 root 3, and then the cosine of a pi over 6 radian angle, we should know that is root 3 over 2, comma. Now our vertical component, that's going to be our magnitude of 2 root 3 times the sine of a pi over 6. That's the one everybody should know, 1 half. So we've got 2's canceling out. Root 3 times itself is a regular 3. Again, we've got 2's canceling out. 3 comma root 3 is our component form. Let's take a look at the next one. Oh, this one doesn't look quite so clean here. I'm going to rotate through an angle of 200 degrees. And once I've reached 200 degrees, I project a vector, a magnitude of 13 units away from the origin to arrive at the head point of that vector. And we've got some components forming up here. We've got an x component that we can tell must be negative to head off to the left. And we've got a y component that must also be negative to head downward. We're going to use our same conversion rule. So our x coordinate, our horizontal component to this vector, will be the magnitude of 13 times the cosine of 200 degrees. And our y component, vertical component, magnitude of 13 times the sine of 200 degrees. And again, that's just coming straight from right triangle trig, opposite over hypotenuse and all that jazz. And what we end up with is a couple of decimals. Remember that whenever we have decimal answers on the AP exam, we want to round to 3 decimal places. So our horizontal component, negative 12.216. Our vertical component, negative 4.446. All right. And that makes sense graphically, right? 200 degrees, we're not rotating much lower than 180 degrees, so the vector should be mostly horizontal, and our components are definitely indicating that. Really close to a 5-12-13 Pythagorean triple. Not quite, though. All right, here we've got some vector addition and scaling to take care of. Again, this is just how you would expect, so we're going to kind of breeze through this. Negative 2u would be distributing a negative 2 into the components of u, negative 6, positive 4. And then I'm adding to that vector v that's been scaled up by 5, negative 10, 25. Well, to add two vectors together, we simply add their corresponding components, negative 6 and negative 10, 4 and 25. There's our resultant. Next one, negative 5 thirteenths u. That gives me negative 15 thirteenths and positive 10 thirteenths plus 12 thirteenths v, negative 24 thirteenths. I like these common denominators. And 60 thirteenths. And when I combine those together, I get, looks like negative 39 thirteenths, that's negative 3, and 10 and 60, 70 thirteenths. All right, now I just went back and read the instructions, and I noticed that I found the component form, but no magnitude. That was intentional. If we have the component form, finding the magnitude is very easy. So let's call our sum vector w. Just because we already have u and v defined. If I want the magnitude of that sum, I'm going to take the square root of the sum of the squares of the components, 16 squared plus 29 squared for this first example. And the result of that, square root of 1,097. And for our second example here, magnitude of this sum, square root of 9 plus, let's see, 70 13th squared will be 4900 over 169. And that simplifies to, I'll leave that to you. We should be pretty good at that by now if we're in Calc BC. Square root of 6421 all over 13. So maybe a little bit of work to come up with an exact answer at the end, but still something that we could manage by hand. Just might take a little while if we were not allowed a calculator. All right, so that's our intro to vectors and kind of refamiliarizing ourselves with the terminology and some of the basic processes. Now we get to the calculus. Particle travels in the plane with a position vector. Find the velocity and the acceleration vector. Well, just like we've covered so far, our velocity vector is going to be the first derivative of each of those components. And you can see that each of them are their own functions. So the velocity in the x direction is going to be determined by sine 2t. That first derivative would be 2 times, derivative of sine is cosine of t. Oops, sorry, 2t. That 2 got multiplied out front because of course, the chain rule. And 2 times cosine t, derivative of cosine is negative sine, so I've got negative 2 times the sine of t. No chain rule to worry about here. That 2, that was a coefficient, simply survived the derivation. Our acceleration, now we're just taking the derivative of our velocity, or the second derivative of position. All right, so I've got another chain rule coming out. It'll be 4, derivative of cosine is negative sine, and we've still got a 2t angle inside. We've already accounted for the chain rule. Derivative of sine is cosine, so for our y component, we get negative 2 cosine of t. And we're done. Very nice, friendly derivative work. All right, our velocity vector v of t. Ooh, here we've got a product rule. First d second. Oh, derivative of sine is just cosine there, Mr. Hertz. Plus second d first. There's my horizontal component. And another product rule. First d second. Okay, that's t times negative sine. So negative t times sine of t. Plus second d first, cosine t times 1. Okay, there's our velocity vector. It's already simplified there for us. Pretty easy product rule, fortunately for us. Acceleration vector, another run-through product rule. Here we've got first d second, t times negative sine of t, plus second d first. And then we've also got this sine of t term that we must derivate as well. Derivative of sine is cosine, so we're adding in another cosine t. Something that we can simplify. Now our horizontal component. We've got another product rule here. So we've got first d second, derivative of sine is cosine, plus second d first, sine of t times negative 1. Make note of that. And then we've got this cosine term that we must derivate as well. Derivative of cosine, negative sine. So let's clean that up. Our acceleration vector is now then, looks like we've got 2 cosine t's, and those are positive. We want to put those out front so we don't lose a negative that's on t sine of t, minus t sine of t. And, oh, both of our terms are negative here in the second, in our vertical component. So we've got negative 2 sine of t minus t cosine of t. There we go. So we've got some object moving, oscillating all around the plane. We can find its acceleration and its velocity simply by derivating the position function. Basic calculus, way back from first semester. Let's try a more delicate one. All right. Oh, never mind. That was it for our velocity and acceleration. Here, example six. Velocity of a particle moving in the plane is given along with the position at time t equals 0. Find the position at time t equals 3. That means we need to find its displacement and add it on to that initial position. Then we need to find the distance the particle travels as it moves from a time equals 0 point to time equals 3 point. All right, so they tell us initially this particle is at the point 7, 2. Okay, that's important. Now, what do we need to make this thing work? We've got our velocity vector. We've got those components. So that's all we need. We want to integrate the velocity to find displacement. So the distance that a particle travels as a vector, so now we're trying to find r of t or p of t, position at time t, equals the integral from 0 to 3 of 2 pi cosine 4t, 4 pi t, sorry, dt, that's its own integral. It's its own function, it gets its own integral. Then from 0 to 3 of 4 pi sine of 2 pi t, dt. Okay. And obviously the heavy lifting is going to be done by this integral, then it's just a matter of interpretation on our part. All right. Let's integrate this first guy. Well, here, let's not put that there. So, the first integral. We do have a pre-function here within our cosine, which means there's a chain rule that applied, which means we're going to need some type of u substitution. So, dealing with this integral, what I can tell is I'm going to need a 4 pi inside. I've got 2 pi. I need to multiply in another 2. And then to keep my integral balanced, I multiply a 1 half outside the integral. That is allowed. So now I've got 1 half times 4 pi, multiply 2 inside, a 1 half outside, times the cosine of 4 pi t dt. Well, now I've got my function and I've got the derivative of the thing inside. So I can call that 1 half integral of cosine of u du. All right, now let's look at the other one. Try and set up a similar structure here. All I need to do is to get the derivative of the thing inside, I need a 2 pi. All I need to do is factor a constant of 2 out of that integral. So 2 times the integral, 0 to 3, 2 pi sine of 2 pi t dt. Now I've got my function of u and I've got du all set up. 2 times the integral of sine u du. And granted, remember our bounds, now that we've changed this new variable u, those bounds have changed. So instead of going from 0 to 3, recall that in this first integral that we set up, here we've let u equal 4 pi t. So my lower bound of 0, if I plug that in for u of t is going to be 4 times pi times 0. So that lower bound stays the same, but this upper bound of 3 is going to change. If I plug in a 3 for t, I get 4 times pi times 3, 12 pi will be my upper bound there. And I need to make a similar adjustment in my sine integral over here. The lower bound will stay the same. Here I'm letting u equal 2 pi t. And when I plug in that upper bound of 3, I find it becomes 6 pi when I put everything in place to work with the variable u. All right, throw some commas in there, space it all out. So here I've got 1 half times, okay, anti-differentiating cosine. Derivative of sine is cosine. So I'm evaluating this from 0 to 12 pi. Remember, we're still in terms of u. And then my other integral, I'm evaluating 2 times, okay, derivative of cosine is negative sine. We're going from 0 to 6 pi. Negative cosine u is what I'll be plugging into. All right, 1 half times the sine at 0 is 0, minus the sine at 12 pi, also 0. So that first term zeroes out. And here with my cosine, I've got the negative cosine at 6 pi, which cosine at 6 pi is 1, so I've got negative 1, minus the negative cosine at 0, which is 1. And hey, I get another 0. So the displacement, what I've traveled, is 0 units horizontally and 0 units vertically. So to find my position at time equals 3, I take my starting point of 7, 2, and I add to that the vector movements 0, 0, and I end up at the point 7, 2 again. It's kind of anticlimactic, right? All that work to find out that the particle ends up right back where it started. And then find the distance the particle actually traveled. We know it got right back to its starting point, but it clearly did a lot of work as time moved on, as those 3 seconds went by, however we want to look at it. The distance from t equals 0 to t equals 3, the distance that traveled is going to be the integral from 0 to 3 of, now we are square rooting the sum of the squares of those components. It's basically like finding the magnitude of the vector and integrating that. So here we've got 2 pi squared, that's 4 pi squared, cosine squared of 4 pi t, plus 16 pi squared sine squared of 2 pi t dt. That's a healthy integral. And as it turns out, these problems, when given in the textbook, require a calculator in order to determine this. If we were to try and, work with this, what we would be trying to do is trying to express this radicand underneath the radical as one term or one factor, a perfect square underneath a square root. And that's just not possible here, even with plenty of trig identity application. Believe me, I tried. So using Math 9, or that FN int feature on the calculator, we would evaluate that integral and find that it travels 28.523 units. Okay, and of course on the AP exam they don't want us to write out what we typed in the calculator or anything like that. We would simply show the integral that we were evaluating and then the answer that we got from that calculation. Last example, we've dealt with trig, now let's handle some exponential functions. Okay, again, our initial point is the point 1, 1. Well, what we need to do is we need to find the vector that integrates from time 0 to time 3, e to the t minus t dt, and then the integral from 0 to 3 of e to the t plus t dt. Okay, that will give us the position that particle moved, or not the position, the total distance traveled in each direction, horizontally and vertically. So, our first integral. This is pretty straightforward integration, so we should be able to evaluate right away. We just have multiple terms. Integral of e to the t is simply e to the t. Integral of negative t would be negative 1 half t squared, and we're evaluating that from 0 to 3. There's our horizontal component. And we can do likewise for our vertical component. Okay. Horizontal component then is e to the third minus 1 half times 3 squared, 9 halves. I'm subtracting away from that e to the zeroth minus negative 1 half to, okay, so minus 0. Sorry, I don't want that apostrophe floating there. And we can clean that up. For the second one, e to the third, second one, our vertical component, plus 1 half times 3 squared, minus e to the 0th, minus 1 half times 0 squared. Okay, and if we want to put this all together, what we get is e to the 3rd minus 11 halves, and e to the 3rd plus 5 halves. All right, and what this works out to be decimally, because again, this is a problem from the textbook where a calculator is required, we find that the distance moved horizontally is 14.586, three decimal places, and vertically we've got 22.586. All right, to answer our first prompt, where is the particle at? Position at time equals 3. Well, we simply add on to the 0.11, the coordinates that we had initially. We know we started off at an x value of 1, then we added a positive 14.586. 15.586 is that ending x value. And we do likewise with the y value. We start off at 1, then we gain 22.586, 23.586 is our ending point. Right, to find the displacement, or the total distance traveled, which is different, the distance traveled, we already found displacement, distance traveled is going to be that integral of the magnitude of our vector. So from 0 to 3, we've got the square root of, the horizontal component, e to the t minus t, squared, plus vertical component, e to the t plus t, that quantity squared, dt. And again, we may try foiling, combining like terms, and we can do some algebra. And if we expand it, and I went ahead and did this, but certainly if a calculator is allowed, you wouldn't have to. By means of algebraic expansion, combining like terms, I got 2e to the 2t plus 2t squared dt, and that was as far as I got, as far as trying to set up a perfect square underneath that square root, just not possible. So then again, turn to the calculator to use numeric integration, and what that result led me to was a total distance of 27.791 units. All right, I know we got talking kind of fast along there, but this is, for the most part, review of something that we covered in pre-calculus, so I feel like we should have been able to handle the pace pretty well. Always nice to see how something that we learned in calculus that or pre-calculus that seemed so abstract or maybe didn't apply itself right away or make sense right away, now it kind of has more of a context to fit in, and that's always nice to see that happen. Here's a look at your assignment for section 11.2.